I have a really exciting presentation to share with you tonight. We're going to be speaking about one of the truly most influential people of the 18th and early 19th century in the history of Jews, particularly in Central Europe, but also, of course, his influence reverberates right through to the present day in our neighborhood here in Brooklyn, as well as in Israel. Is a very consequential thinker who articulated a strategy for Jewish survival under the uncertain terms of the Enlightenment, of the modern period. I'm sure that his approach will be thought-provoking, perhaps challenging, maybe even startling for some of you, but one thing you certainly have to give the Chasam Sofer, our subject tonight, is that he really did figure out a way to guarantee Jewish survival. Maybe we'll have room to discuss the consequences of his particular strategy over the course of the next hour. But I want to, first of all, let me just say quickly, reminder, and I have it in the middle of the lecture too, so for those who come in a little bit later, we are going to be at 2002 Avenue J next week. It's just three blocks this way. It's a very short walk. We have a really nice, intimate space. It's the main auditorium there. Doesn't have a lot of the extra room around the sides, but we should be able to fit in there very nicely. And I hope you'll join me for just 1 week of this series down the street at the new building for the Machon Parnassa campus. Let's go straight to the material. It's so exciting. We will come back to talking about locations. So the Chasam Sofer, I want to do things a little bit differently today. Normally, when I give these biographical lectures, I sort of give you the arc of, you know, the context of his or her times and birth and family, and then major achievements, challenges, and then I end with death and legacy. But tonight, what I'd like to do is I'd like to go from the other end and spend some time talking about an amazing installation of public art that surrounds the Chasam Sofer's grave. For those of you who follow me on the internet, you've probably seen, I was so overwhelmed by this experience that I recorded a 13-minute video about 3 weeks ago, which goes over the first 5 or 6 minutes of our presentation tonight. So forgive me, because I'm going to repeat that. But I was so taken by this. It was such a beautiful thing that we have to start with it. So first of all, who is the Chasam Sofer? Here's the classic image of the Chasam Sofer. He is a very important thinker. His name is actually Rabbi Moshe Schreiber. Chasam Sofer, or Hatam Sofer, is the his nom de plume, his pseudonym when he wrote his books under that title. We'll explore what that means shortly. Very important thinker at the cusp of modernity, a very difficult time when Jews were trying to figure out their relationship to the modern world as a whole. Classic image that's been reproduced in many different places, most likely a more authoritative representation of how he actually looked. He was quite active in the entire Danube region, but his claim to fame is in modern-day Bratislava, which is known by its historic name, Pressburg, or Pressburg in Yiddish, the capital of Hungary for quite some time before Budapest, and a very important center for Jews in East Central Europe. So let's talk about his grave, as I mentioned, because I think it's just an absolutely fascinating thing. This is the exterior of his grave when you first come up to it. I knew when I was touring with the Kosher River Cruises, I knew that we were going to visit the kever of the Chasam Sofer. I figured, okay, very nice. I've been to lots of kivrei tzaddikim, the graves of righteous people over the generations. It's often a very moving experience, you know, and there are many different kind of interesting customs that are observed at these places. And I was prepared for something along that sort of textbook definition. I was completely blown away by what I saw. We're driving along on the bus in Pressburg, right by the Danube River, and I just happened to look out the window and I noticed this phalanx of these glass or plexiglass green obelisks that seem to rise out of the ground in a very rigid formation. They're not all identical. Some are pebbled, some are transparent. They're all translucent. They don't seem to have any marker that indicates what their purpose is. And I remember looking out the window and thinking, Vos Epis, what exactly is this that I'm looking at? And I didn't realize that, of course, this is the first encounter you have with the grave of the Chasam Sofer. Here's a better picture. You can see there's 23 of them lined up. That's a very significant number, as we shall see shortly. It's kind of on an inclined hill that's reminiscent of like an archaeological tell. You don't know what's underneath this mound, but it has kind of like a strange, eerie sort of look, especially because there's no explicit marker as to what it is that you're looking at. Next to these glass obelisks is this sort of large slot-like structure, this black looming thing that penetrates into the mound. It's got this tiny little entrance over here on the right, and you can see by the scale, this is a person walking out of the entrance. And it looks, you know, it's evocative of some kind of like entry into the underworld, which actually quite literally it is, as you shall see. It's imposing and dark and foreboding, and it doesn't seem to have, once again, any kind of clear indication as to what is going on inside this building. Going into the actual structure, you see it's got this Ohel-like structure, as many of you may have visited the local shrines we have, for example, to the Lubavitcher Rebbe. They refer to his grave as an Ohel, a tent, and one of the unusual things about it is, of course, it has no roof. It's just walls surrounding, separating the graves from the rest of the cemetery. This, too, has no roof, but it's long and narrow and somewhat forbidding. You walk down this angled surface, dimly lit with these floor lamps here, and when you get to the very end of it, it's just a black tunnel right down about, you know, 60 feet or so. Then you come to this sign, which is recorded in several languages. Obviously in English, this is a sacred place. Admission granted strictly upon modest clothing, body and head properly covered. It says it also in German and in Slovak, and of course at the top it says it in Hebrew. Now I posed this question when I taught a master class here at Turo last week, and the only person to answer correctly and immediately was of course a senior vice president who is a very smart woman. The translations are almost identical, except the Hebrew has one small distinction. What is that small distinction in Hebrew for those of you who are literate? Oh my gosh, you see, we had one senior VP in a room full of educators, but in this room there are 12 of you already who are headed for that. So yes, it says Makom Kodesh Lifanecha, translated as this is a holy place before you. And it has just that one word has kind of an invitation that, okay, for Slovaks and Germans and English speakers, Anglophones, this is a holy place. But for Jews, this is Lefanecha. This is before you. There's an invitation there, a special connection. Which reminds me, by the way, I will tell you a very quick joke because before we go to the next. I was once in Odessa with my wife, and the plumbing had broken. And by the elevator, there was a sign. And because Odessa is a very international city, the sign was written just like this in many different languages, in French and English and German and Russian, Ukrainian, and so on. And in almost all the languages, it said, the plumbing is broken. You know, please don't flush the toilets, whatever. And then in German, it said, the plumbing is broken. Please don't flush the toilets. We called the plumber. He said he couldn't come till Tuesday. We begged him. He says he'll be here on Monday, but he might not have the parts. It was like a ganze Geschichte, like as if the Germans need to know every single detail what's going on with the plumbing. Okay, back to the serious stuff here. Anyways, so you see this sign at the right angle before you make the turn actually into the tomb itself. And what do you see when you go in there? I'm not going to show you right away. First, I want to give you a little history. So the original site of the graves, it's right down here, is actually where the graves are located. This is a pre-war photograph of the old Jewish cemetery, which dates, I believe, to the 15th or the 16th century. You can see it's on the bank of the Danube River. And it's filled with several hundred or perhaps thousand graves, and during the World War II era, the local dictator named Tiso decided he wanted to pave it over and make a tram line there. The Jewish community, this is immediately prior to their deportation, eventual murder, they begged Tiso, please, allow us to at least reinter the bones of our ancestors. And he ultimately, on the payment of a large bribe, allowed them. But he was apparently somewhat perturbed because there was a rumor going about that anyone who disturbed the bones of the Chasam Sofer and of his immediate retinue in the next world buried next to him would suffer grave curses. And so therefore, he would not allow them to reinter the bones of the Chasam Sofer. And instead, what he did was he built a sarcophagus around the grave. Here you can see the construction of it. This is the actual tombstone of the Chasam Sofer. And they built this concrete box that would eventually be sealed over, and that was going to be the undisturbed last resting place of the Chasam Sofer. Once it was put into place, then all of the Jews of Bratislava were sent to the death camps, and in fact the location was paved over for this tram line. The tram, as it happened, was hardly used, but nevertheless that's where the grave was, right here under the section where the two lines meet. So that's the initial history of the grave. How did it come to be reopened? So with the fall of communism, the Jewish community, with some significant support, obviously, from the wealthier American Jewish community, including some people prominent in Turo who asked not to be named, donated a large amount of money to build an appropriate tomb for the Chasam Sofer that would allow people to come and visit his grave. So they contacted this non-Jewish architect named Kvasnitsa, whose only experience until this point was building a kosher kitchen for the local Jewish community. Specifically, he built it for the rabbi on the left there, Baruch Myers, who is the chief rabbi of Slovakia, a nice Jewish boy from New Jersey, a Chabad rabbi, of course. The guy in the middle is me, and the guy on the right is my colleague, the Prague Jewish historian, David Krauss. And they organized the funds to allow Kvasnitsa to create this amazing structure. Let's go into it now. When you make that, you'll recall you walk down that slot-like entrance, and it's kind of foreboding, and you have this anticipation, what's on the other side of it? You make this sharp 90-degree left turn, and what happens is you go into this underground vault. The inside of the original sarcophagus that was created by Tiso, and the graves are all laid out here and lit with a solemn kind of lighting. But look at the top of the picture here, and you see the bottoms of the 23 glass obelisks reach through the surface of the sarcophagus, as if to create a kind of poetic image that the souls of those interred here cannot be held by the earth, that they rise through the surface of the earth into the world of the living, and they continue to have their influence on our world today. Very powerful visual statement, a non-verbal statement, of a kind of a poetic symbol that you only appreciate when you actually walk into this very quiet, solemn space. It's actually a very powerful, overwhelming experience. My wife and I went to that far corner, and then we said psalms for the entire family, and it was really quite a moving experience. Here is a close-up look at the Chasam Sofer's grave itself, the tzion, the marker, which says Moshe Sofer, from the holy city of Main, Frankfurt of Main, and on top you can see another view of the obelisks. So it's a really amazing place to visit, a very powerful experience. I don't think there is any kever like this. I've certainly never seen a grave like this anywhere else in the world. The others were moved uphill to the newer Jewish cemetery, and they were reinterred there. The live Jews who conducted that particular operation, unfortunately, did not themselves survive, because they would be gassed in the death chamber shortly thereafter. Okay, let's go on. Here's the important good and welfare. Next week, as I mentioned, 2002 Avenue J, right just down the street, the Montauk building. It's hard to miss, a beautiful, gorgeous building, exterior lighting. Not maybe as beautiful as the grave of the Chasam Sofer, but nevertheless, quite meaningful. It's at the corner of J and Ocean Avenue, and go in the side entrance down to the main auditorium. Since we're talking good and welfare, very quickly, I want to remind people of a couple things. First of all, once again, we do these lectures, first of all, because we have fun. It's great to study Jewish history. It's intrinsically interesting and fascinating, and I'm glad that to share this with you. But we're also trying to raise money for our students. So if you know some ridiculously wealthy people who would love to give money to educate the next generation, we will be glad to help them out with that. If you're worried about, you know, missing lectures or catching up the videos and things like that, go to my website, please. And notice here, I put this happy arrow over here. It says follow. And if you click on this button, you will be prompted with, like, how would you like to follow? And you can put in your email address, or you can like on Facebook or whatever you prefer to be able to follow lectures. But this is really the only way I have now to communicate with you. You know, it's this year, unfortunately, I don't have an intern to help out with, you know, the various odds and ends of putting this lecture together. So this is the only way I can manage all of the communication skills. This is, the website is called Henry Abramson. It's easy. Just Google my name and you will find all kinds of embarrassing dental records and stuff like that. Okay, there it is. See, right? I zoomed in on it. Okay, let's go to the lecture itself. So we looked at the kever. We did this lecture a little bit backwards by looking at the monument to his earthly remains. But let's look at his actual life. Here's a famous photograph of Rabbi Schreiber, a piece of art. You can see the facial expression is clearly derived from the other drawing we have him. This is his father-in-law, the great Rabbi Akiva Eger. His second wife was Rabbi Akiva Eger's daughter, and the two of them together were really a tremendous impact on Central European Jewry. Let us just focus on the pronunciation of his name for a second. So obviously the Yiddish, you see Moshe Schreiber. Schreiber is Yiddish for writer or scribe. And when he wrote his writings in Hebrew, he preferred to refer to himself as the Hatam Sofer. That would be a Sephardi pronunciation, or at least a poor imitation of a Sephardi pronunciation, which means the seal of the scribe. Chatam Sofer, Sephardi pronunciation. Obviously, some of the consonants are slightly different, and the emphasis tends to be on the last syllable. But the Ashkenazi pronunciation tends to be on the first syllable. It would be Chasam Sofer. In fact, the first word has only one syllable, Chasam, right? It's a difficult thing to say, Chasam Sofer. So I may wander back and forth between those two pronunciations. He was famous for two principal reasons. First of all, he was an incredible scholar, a phenomenal grasp of Jewish thought and Jewish texts that spanned the entire corpus of rabbinic literature, and he wrote extensively, although hardly anything was published in his lifetime. Most of it was published after he passed away, but he wrote primarily responsa, a commentary on the Torah, a beautiful commentary on the ethical classic, Chovot HaLevavot, the duties of the heart. He even wrote Hebrew poetry, really a tremendously prolific author. His family was also a legacy, and that legacy permeates even contemporary life. As I mentioned, he married a second wife. His first wife, unfortunately, died childless in 1812. His second wife was the daughter of Rabbi Akiva Eger, sown here. And of his 11 children, 10 of them survived. Many of them went on to great posts of authority, and there's a yeshiva in his name here in Brooklyn, also in Jerusalem, and of course his intellectual legacy is really imprinted within the Orthodox world in particular, and especially in the ultra-Orthodox world. We'll have to explore some of those things. His roots are in the city of Frankfurt am Main, a very important German city where he was born and raised. There are a couple of stories I'd like to tell you about his youth, which are really quite amazing. His mother was known as Rezele Tzadekis, Rezel, Rose, the righteous woman. And the legend of his birth that I find most charming and takes me is that apparently she went into labor on a Friday afternoon. And as many communities do, including Frankfurt am Main, the custom was to bring in the Sabbath early, right? Because depending on the latitude and longitude of a particular place, if you wait till sunset to bring in the Sabbath, that can mean that you're having your Friday evening meal. You know, if you come from parts of England, it might be 11 o'clock at night in the summer, things like that. So it's a custom to start the Sabbath early, even while it's bright outside. So she was going into labor, and just as the community was beginning to start the cycle of prayers for the Sabbath, she sent a message with one of the midwives to rush into the synagogue, speak to the rabbi, and ask him to hold up the entire community and not bring in the Sabbath until she had delivered. Because obviously the delivery takes precedence over the Sabbath. You are not only allowed to, you're required to attend to the medical needs of a mother and a newborn child on the Sabbath. But since it was in that period of like voluntary acceptance of Sabbath, she preferred that the community hold off, the entire community hold off, and that would be no even question of Sabbath desecration on her account. The rabbi amazingly agreed. And they were just before Lecha Dodi, and they sat down, and they all sat and studied. And then about 20, 30 minutes later, a messenger comes in and says that a baby was born, and you can go ahead and bring in the Sabbath right now. And the rabbi proclaimed his name. The rabbi said he's definitely going to be named Moshe, because he is going to be the deliverer of the Jewish people. Beautiful story about the origins of this young man. There's also more fascinating stories about the unique practices of the Sofer family with regard to their young child. He was, and this is a very strange custom, I've never seen it myself, but I have read about it every now and then. He was veiled as a child. He was not allowed to walk about in the street, being able to look at whatever he wanted. Obviously, I assume he was not veiled at home, he was not veiled in the backyard and things like that, but when they would go walking in the street, in order to avoid his seeing anything negative, they actually covered his face, which is somewhat reminiscent in my, you know, unfortunately polluted mind. I think of Siddhartha Gautama, who was also similarly sheltered from the outside world. He turned out rather differently, I think, than the Chasam Sofer. But at any rate, he was veiled on his way to learn Torah, and it was only when he was about 3 years old that they actually removed the veil when he walked in public. His parents had very definite ideas about his education. At one point, apparently the Chasam Sofer, as a young boy, when he was in his Rebbe's class, I believe he was about 7 years old or so, and the teacher, the rabbi, translated a phrase in Genesis as the creation of Adam. He says, "And God took earth from the earth." In Yiddish, "Erd von der Erd." And the young Chasam Sofer, Moshe, put up his hand and asked the Rebbe, he says, "Rebbe, that can't be the right translation, because why would it say God took earth from the earth? Obviously, you take only earth from the earth. It must teach something different." Of course, in Hebrew, those are two different words. But the Rebbe did not have perhaps the facility of the understanding of the Hebrew language to find synonyms or more accurate translations for those two terms. And so, at a loss for words, he decided to strike the young boy. And he gave him a punch, which, looking around the room, I think most of you probably experienced that pedagogic style. I know my knuckles still hurt thinking about all the raps I got with the yardstick over my hands. My kids, they have no clue of what it was like to be a kid back in the 1960s. But at any rate, the child came home, because it was a good question, right? Why would you translate this as earth from the earth? It must mean something else. And so immediately the Rabbi Sofer's father took him out of school and homeschooled him right then. Right, homeschooling in the, I guess this would be probably the 1860s, was an entirely different adventure than homeschooling. 1760s, thank you. It was an entirely different venture than today. He tended to outgrow his teachers, however, and when he turned 9 years old, it was decided that he should in fact study with Rabbi Nussan Adler, a fascinating individual who probably should be the subject of one of our biographical talks one night. Rabbi Adler was known to be a deep Kabbalist in Frankfurt, very, very pious individual, highly respected. He used the Sephardic Kabbalistic liturgy rather than the traditional Ashkenazic liturgy. And on a few occasions, he fell into some conflict with the community as a whole, and specifically the local rabbinic establishment that was led by Rabbi Pinchas Horowitz, who was also Rabbi Sofer's teacher. Rabbi Sofer actually moved in and lived with Rabbi Adler and had a lifelong attachment to him, this deep, isolated Kabbalist who at one point was actually put into excommunication by Rabbi Horowitz and the rest of the members of the community. There was no question in the town about his piety and about his sincere desire to serve God in every way, but the problem was we're living in a period where there's still the reverberations of the Sabbatean controversy, which we've discussed in previous years. If you recall, in 1660s there was a very devastating false messianic movement that came to a horrible close when Shabbatai Tzvi left his followers and converted to Islam, and huge swaths of Jewish populations were left impoverished and completely depressed because their hopes for a Messiah were crashed with the Shabbatai Tzvi's defection to another faith. After he died, there were several other quasi-Shabbatean movements that swept across Europe. Sometimes they were explicit, and in fact there were these pockets of Sabbatean communities throughout the region. Sometimes they were suspected, kind of like it was a McCarthyist kind of era where anybody who had any kind of like Kabbalistic leanings was suspected of being a secret follower of Shabbatai Tzvi. So in this environment, which affected some of the greatest rabbis of the era, Rabbi Adler was placed into excommunication for a brief period of time, and Rabbi Moshe Sofer, however, followed his teacher into exile and would prefer to stay with his teacher even despite the negative influence that was surrounding him at that time, or the negative, not influence, but the cloud of mistrust that was surrounding him. There were also questions about specifically the influence of Hasidism on both Rabbi Adler and Rabbi Horowitz. Hasidism, you recall, is still very young at this point in its history. The Baal Shem Tov, who was the father of the Hasidic movement, passes away around 1760, and the movement is handed off to his principal disciple, the Maggid of Meserich. And this is all happening quite a ways away in Eastern Europe, but there's no question that the impact is being felt throughout the land, particularly when the controversy between the Hasidim and the Misnagdim heats up towards the end of the 18th century. So questions of the degree to which Hasidic ideas had penetrated into this more straightforward Misnagdic community were prevalent, and also, as I mentioned, the idea of practical Kabbalah. What is practical Kabbalah? I should quickly define that. Kabbalistic literature tends to be, or can be, divided into two major categories. This is a very rough definition. One category would be what we call theoretical Kabbalah, meaning answering questions like, what is the structure of the universe? What is the meaning of evil in the universe? What is the soul? What happens to soul after people die? Kind of like just general theoretical questions, sort of like a textbook of physics, but in this case, Kabbalah. And that is definitely pretty esoteric material and tends to be reserved for the elite. But it's not in itself feared. The same way that practical Kabbalah is. Practical Kabbalah, or theurgic Kabbalah, to use a technical term, means it's probably closer to the English term magic, meaning using all this knowledge to cast spells or to write Kameot amulets that have special power, sometimes a nefarious power, sometimes to be used in business dealings or in affairs of the heart and things like that, sometimes to, try to aggressively demand that God send the Messiah. All kinds of interesting projects fall within the purview of practical Kabbalah. And although theoretical Kabbalah is well respected and is considered the purview of the elite, the great scholars, practical Kabbalah is considered an extremely dangerous venture and was excoriated throughout Eastern Europe by rabbis who felt that if it was in the wrong hands, it would be a very destructive influence. So there was questions about Rabbi Adler and the composition of these amulets that eventually drove him into Cherem. But as I mentioned earlier, Rabbi Sofer interestingly chose to remain with his teacher rather than give in to the dominant position of the antagonist. In the end, when Rabbi Adler grew ill, the excommunication was formally lifted, and at his funeral, Rabbi Horowitz delivered the lead eulogy as a gesture of healing after a very difficult period of controversy. So he grew up in Frankfurt am Main, educated primarily by traditional Talmudists like Rabbi Horowitz, and also heavily influenced by a Kabbalist like Rabbi Adler, and then he turned to Pressburg. Here is a period photograph of Pressburg. You can see at the top of this hill, this is the Danube flowing along here, you have this kind of like staid looking castle at the top of the mountain. The locals apparently refer to it as the tabletop because it looks like an inverted table. It's not exactly the Disney kind of model of a castle with, you know, turrets and chambers and things like that. It's a rather conventional in its look, rather pedestrian. Here's a view from when I was there last month, standing on the top of the castle, and here's the Danube flowing. You can see over here they have this this more modern kind of bridge here, which has a restaurant at the top with a revolving bridge up there. The locals call it the UFO. I don't know why. Apparently, there was a major synagogue over here on this side of the river that was destroyed in order to make room for the bridge to cross the river here. This was kind of like a liquid Berlin Wall, as Austria is just off to the side over here. And Austria, of course, was a neutral country after World War II, and many Soviet citizens attempted to make the crossing to the west by getting themselves to Bratislava and then braving the waters of the Danube, which is not all that wide. It's not an incredibly difficult swim, but they had to risk being shot by Soviet snipers who were trying to prevent them from gaining access to the west. So it was in this town that Rabbi Sofer made his name. He came here in the early 1800s, and he established an incredibly large yeshiva that was extremely popular, and he attracted followers from miles around. His most important area of activism, as I mentioned earlier, he's famous for really two reasons. One is he was a great scholar with tremendous rabbinic, you know, erudition and publications and so on, and we've studied many of those people. But he was also a firebrand. He also had a very sharp sense of what Jews needed to do in the present moment, and no one was more opposed to him than Moses Mendelssohn, shown here, who had predeceased him, but was an extremely influential figure. Let's just quickly think about what Moses Mendelssohn stood for. So he was called the genius of Berlin, a rather highly intellectual individual with a tremendous gift for languages, which he utilized to great success by entering academic essay competitions and so on. Apparently, he even bested the great Immanuel Kant in an essay competition. And this was really quite an achievement because this is well before Jews had achieved emancipation. Emancipation would be, in fact, the goal of Jews in Europe right up until the early 20th century, depending on which part of the continent we look at. What do I mean by emancipation? So this term comes to us in American Jewish historiography. We obviously borrowed it from the Civil War era, where emancipation was used in the context of the slavery of African Americans, that they had to be emancipated or freed. I think a more accurate term would be manumitted, because they were slaves and they were given freedom. This term was appropriated by Jewish historians wishing to describe the situation of the Jews in 18th century and 19th century Europe. It's not an exact fit, because Jews were not, in fact, enslaved. They just suffered from a discriminatory regime that differed significantly between the various countries of Western and Eastern Europe. The kind of disabilities that they suffered were primarily related to the issue of citizenship. were they to be considered complete citizens, as they were in France beginning in 1791, a little bit earlier for the Sephardic Jews of France because they were more acculturated, or were they to be considered fundamentally foreigners with temporary residence permits? This is, in fact, what pertained in the Russian Empire right up until it fell in 1917. Jews had passports or internal documents that literally called them inozemnich, or foreigners, and they had a limited amount of residence rights in Russia. And they could have been there for 1,000 years. They would still nevertheless be considered foreigners. Like I myself, I actually laughed the other day. You know, people comment on the YouTube videos that I put these lectures up on YouTube. People comment on them, and, you know, sometimes they're fun to read. And what was the one that I saw the other day that made me laugh? Oh, yes. Maybe you remember. I think it was not that long ago. I happened to pronounce the name of the Dutch governor of Manhattan. Do you remember who that was? Stuyvesant, right? Stuyvesant. So apparently, in my ignorance, I said Stuyvesant, which is, that's how you spell it. That's how you say Stuyvesant. Look, I don't speak American very well. And so the guy wrote on the YouTube comment, he says, you know, Americans know it's pronounced Stuyvesant. Go back to Canada. So I'm like, wow. I feel so unwelcome in this country, you know. What is it with this country and immigrants, you know? But I have a little bit of that feeling of identification. A person who does not have citizenship rights they don't have rights at all. They have tolerances, right? I am tolerated in this country. As long as I do not commit a felony, as long as I, you know, am productive, have a job and things like that, so I'm allowed to live here, and I think that's great. Thankfully, four of my kids are born in this country, so they're anchor babies, and I get to like stay here because I stay with them. But in Russia and other places, Jews could lose their residency rights at any moment. They could be forced to leave, as they did in Russia. They would be forced out of like 15 versts from the border. They could be forced to move and move inward, inland, so that they would not be trading across the border. They could be denied the right to access universities, denied the right to, well, I say the right to, we use those terms. They could be denied the privilege of attending university, denied the privilege to engage in this or that occupation. All kinds of things could be imposed on them because fundamentally, as non-citizens, they have no rights. So the argument in the 18th century was to emancipate the Jews from this tenuous state of being permanent residents to becoming citizens and having all of the same rights and privileges of non-Jews living in the same region. Mendelssohn was the primary proponent of that movement, which had a political expression, and it also had an intellectual expression. He was much more associated with the intellectual expression of it, meaning his argument for emancipation was that Jews can be productive, active members of society. They represent a human resource, intellectual capital that can be harnessed to the will of the state. If only the state would recognize that Jews wish to belong, they wish to be patriotic, they wish to be contributing members of society, simply allow them to exercise that natural love of one's homeland, and they will in fact be, you know, worthy members of society, and everyone will benefit. And so Mendelssohn sought to demonstrate this in so many different ways. He argued, for example, that Jews should be absolutely fluent in the vernacular of the land. This was not necessarily true. Even in German-speaking lands, Jews spoke Yiddish, which, as I've mentioned in the past, I think Billy Crystal calls German with phlegm. Thank you. I know some of you heard that before. That's why they didn't. Shall I say it again, David? One more time? Billy Crystal says Yiddish is German with phlegm. Okay, all right. I should have cut it out. I'll cut that piece out of the internet. So he argued that Jews should speak German well. They should not be speaking with country bumpkin accents, even though German and Yiddish are very closely related languages. They should be, you know, able to express themselves with the height of fluidity. There should be no hesitation. They should have total command of the language and so on. He argued that, you know, there's no reason for Jews to hold fast to customs that have no clear basis in the Jewish religious tradition, meaning modalities of clothing, of grooming, various, you know, attitudes and behaviors that are sort of like cultural accretions that are not necessarily something that is in the code of Jewish law and certainly not in earlier texts. The argument that many of his followers would, he, this is not his phrase particularly, but he says a person should be a Jew at home and a man in the street, meaning just like everybody else in the street, but at home, that's where you practice your Judaism. And in fact, many of his followers took this to a much further degree. They preferred to use the term German of Mosaic persuasion, meaning they were true Germans, even though they didn't have citizenship yet. It happened that the church that they worshipped in was a synagogue, right? So there's this is a whole attitude which was enshrined in what was called the Haskalah, or enlightenment. That's the Hebrew translation of the term Aufklärung. And the and Mendelssohn was kind of like the flashpoint of it, and the first real mover of the Haskalah as a movement. His followers would take it to tremendous lengths, and in fact, just one or two generations after him, many Maskilim openly advocated slavish imitation of non-Jewish norms. We see it in areas like, in particular, in areas like synagogue architecture, synagogue decorum, synagogue ritual. They successfully actually moved Shabbos to Sunday, but popular resentment simply couldn't handle that, so Shabbos was moved back to Saturday. And we can see all kinds of interesting, you know, movements that the later inheritors of the Haskalah would go to any length to try and demonstrate that they were good German citizens. The conversion rate to Lutheranism in particular was off the charts, as you know, the second, third generation of followers of Mendelssohn felt like, hey, this is not working. It's just not, we're not getting where we want to. I think we just have to make a pro forma conversion and then things will come to pass. And one of the saddest things I think about Mendelssohn's life was that all of his grandchildren converted to Christianity. He was not able to have any kiyum. I believe I read recently that in fact one branch of the family may have returned, but I'm not 100% sure about that. Now, and one other key fact was fascinating, I think. Mendelssohn's prime literary achievement was he wrote a translation of the Bible with a commentary called the Biur. And it was written in Hebrew on one side and in Judeo-German on the other side. And while the Maskilim thought this was a great idea because Jews could learn German properly, they knew the Hebrew text very well, and they could learn German properly by following his translation, the traditionalists were aghast because it meant this was a window open to the outside world, and in fact it would lead to the tremendous dissolution of the Jewish body politic, and they were not far wrong. So he was extremely opposed to the Chasam, so the works of Mendelssohn. Let me just remind myself what I'm talking about next. Yes, oh my gosh, I'm almost at the end, so I have to talk a little bit more about this part here. So in his writings, very sharp writing against the works of Moses Mendelssohn, the Chasam Sofer emerged as the leading figure of East Central Europe. And he had an incredible wit and a biting tongue, and he was not hesitant at all to put his words to paper in a continent-wide polemic against the gains that the reformers were having throughout this period. I use the term reformer with a small r, but there are definite links to what we would call the reform movement today from Mendelssohn's thought. Perhaps the most famous of the Chasam Sofer's positions was he borrowed a text from the Mishnah that is, it's kind of, you have to like, just give me a second to explain this because it's sort of weird. There is a particular harvest of wheat There's a period of time when the wheat is harvested. It's called new wheat, or in Hebrew, chadash. And it may not be consumed until after the holiday of Shavuot, which occurs usually in late summer. And so this chadash, this new wheat, is forbidden by the Torah. So the it actually says explicitly in the Mishnah that this new wheat is forbidden by the Torah. But in Hebrew, you don't have to say the word wheat. You can just say the new is forbidden by the Torah. The Chasam Sofer took this phrase and he made it his clarion call, saying the new is forbidden by the Torah, meaning anything new is forbidden by the Torah. And the Chasam Sofer took a very aggressive stance on this, saying that the onslaught of the Enlightenment is so profound that giving it even an inch, giving any compromise to it, will bring the entire structure of Judaism to collapse. And so he took a very hard line, and he said there is no way that we can budge on any of the suggestions, even if they seem rather innocuous. He said the new is forbidden by the Torah in all circumstances. Very, very strong political position, which is contrasted with several other strategies that were articulated at the time. For example, the strategy of Samson Raphael Hirsch, that I have not shown here, I probably should have brought a picture of him, who was also in Frankfurt at this time. Samson Raphael Hirsch argued that the Enlightenment was really too strong for traditional Judaism. He's living, recall, a little bit further west in Germany as opposed to in Hungary, where the Chasam Sofer is, and he felt that the gravitational pull of modernity is so powerful that Jews cannot resist it outright the way the Chasam Sofer is saying. So he argued for a careful moderation of the demands of Judaism with the demands of modernity, not to say that he would compromise any of the core beliefs or practices of Judaism, but he said, listen, it doesn't say anywhere in the Torah that a Jew is forbidden to wear a short coat, like this, for example. This is called a dacher, a German coat, because this is what the was considered, like, this was like horribly... what's the right word? It's risque, you know, like this is something you wouldn't even wear it on a beach back in the 1860s, right? This is considered very revealing. So he said there's nothing that forbids a Jew from wearing a short coat. It's true that traditionally, at least for the last couple hundred years, we've worn these long kaftans, but how is a Jew different for wearing a short coat? And so Samson Raphael Hirsch's philosophy argued for a careful practice by practice evaluation of Jewish norms and to adapt those to what can be adapted to modernity. This is Yekis jacket, exactly right. Germans are called Yekis because they wear these short jackets, right? There you go. Thank you for reminding me. So I'm using this as a contrast to the Chasam Sofer. The Chasam Sofer said, whoa, my gosh, if they're suggesting that we should wear short coats, absolutely not. We are not changing our coats at all. Even in the middle of the summer, we're not changing, not at all. Forget about white hats after Labor Day, nothing. It reminds me, once I was walking down the street in Florida. I lived in Florida for a long time, and one of my friends was a ger chassid, and we were walking to shul on an August day, and if you've been in Florida in August, you know it's like having a big hot blanket on your body, you know, big 50-pound blanket, and just the humidity, and we're schwitzing, and he's walking along in his full regalia with the big hat and the long black jacket, and he turns to me and says, I am so glad they did not have galoshes in 18th century Poland, right? Because otherwise he would be wearing rubber galoshes as he's walking along the floor. So the Chasam Sofer would say, sorry? They never met. They never met. He died in 786, so he was 1762. I'm unaware of them ever meeting. I do not believe they ever did. Very harsh criticism, and the strategy that the Chasam Sofer articulated was complete and utter resistance to modernity. Stay away. There's some interesting kind of counterintuitive gestures that the Chasam Sofer indicated. Like, for example, he was very much against secular studies in the yeshiva, not surprising. But on the other hand, he was much more tolerant of, for example, physical education. He believed that it was important that the yeshiva students all knew how to swim. He used to have swimming classes in the Danube River to make sure that Jews knew how to swim, things like that, which is, you won't find too many yeshivas doing that today. Another thing that is extremely important for our times, and this is so close to us today, those of us who are observant of the tradition, that it's hard to recognize how we got to this place, but the Chasam Sofer had a very important part in it. Let me just introduce this point by describing for you once a situation when I was learning in a yeshiva in Muncie, and I was studying Mishnah Brura, which is a classic halachic 20th century treatise on standard behavior, and I'm reading through various things, and I get to this one passage, and I'm reading it, and reading it again, and reading it a third time, and it's confusing, because what it's telling us to do is exactly the opposite of what people actually do today. It had to do with how a particular blessing was recited. And I looked it up in the Holy Art Scroll Siddur, and I looked it up in all kinds of places, and I saw that, in fact, we contemporary American Jews and the odd Canadian do not follow what it says in the Mishnah Brura. So I was very troubled by this. I went to Rabbi Kokos, Mencion Kokos, who was the Mashgiach, and I said, Rabbi, I don't understand. You know, we're not holding like the Mishnah Brura. And he said to me, I'll never forget it, who says we hold like the Mishnah Brura? Which I thought was like such an earth-shattering concept. What do you mean? This is it. This is the code. This is this is what we follow. It's the law court. I mean, this is everything. But in fact, we should understand that halacha does have a certain amount of, I guess the phrase would be wiggle room. You know, we have the phrase in Torah of the dalet amos of halacha, the four cubits of halacha. If you ever measured out four cubits, it's a lot of space. Four cubits is close to 6 feet. In 6 feet square, you can put a lot of different opinions. You can put a lot of different people. Now, it's true that we tend to coalesce around certain opinions. Sephardim will follow certain bodies of opinions. Ashkenazim will follow certain bodies of opinions. And God forbid that I'm suggesting that anyone, you know, deviate from their customs or their community and things like that. But one of the things that the Chasam Sofer, one of his strategies that has affected us is that he absolutely canonized the Shulchan Aruch as a text. Now, the Shulchan Aruch is a very important text. It is the code of Jewish law, but it is not the only code of Jewish law at all. We had prior codes written by greats such as Maimonides. We have codes that disagree fundamentally with what the Shulchan Aruch has to say, notably the Ramah, Rabbi Moshe Isserles. And it is in the debate between the various commentators that we make contemporary halacha. It's not a straightforward, just look it up, what it says there, and that's all you need. Like they say, the Litvak says, what do I need a rabbi for? I have a book, right? I don't need a rabbi because everything's in the book. But the fact is, not everything is in the book. And the book is a rigid, dead text. It's not sensitive to the immediacies of the social and chronological and geographic and cultural moment that a rabbi, a human being, could be. But sensing that the flexibility of halacha was something that would not serve the Jews well in a time when compromise was so dangerous, the Chasam Sofer rigidly adhered to the words of the text and urged his followers with great success to turn to the text, specifically the Shulchan Aruch, as the primus unter pares, as the great work that is the last word on halacha. Even though intrinsically it is not, he himself added to halachic interpretation by writing about the Shulchan Aruch, he definitely focused us more as a text-based people. And although we gained we became much more grounded in an authoritative tradition that goes back many centuries, it also enforced a certain level of rigidity that is perhaps somewhat artificial on a historical level. There's a classic article by Dr. Soloveitchik, not related to the Soloveitchiks, of course, but the historian Soloveitchik, that looks at the issue of something as simple as how big was a Kiddush cup back in the 1800s. Today we have, if you've gone to a Passover Seder like at my table, we have all these measurements and we get a little bit OCD trying to figure out how the matzah fits into the box and how much matzah exactly we're eating. They never had things like that in Eastern Europe. They just had, this is the way Zaidi did it. This is the kind of organic Mesorah, the organic tradition that we follow from our ancestors. This has changed quite a bit because, in certain part, to the Chasam Sofer's emphasis on the Shulchan Aruch as our text de rigueur. It also is something that unfortunately we suffer from because we are an orphan generation, lacking that connection to Europe often because of the cataclysm of the Holocaust. So those two aspects are especially important for the Chasam Sofer's thought. On the one hand, his incredible opposition to reform, and secondly, his adherence to the Shulchan Aruch as the defining halakhic text of the era. So let us conclude appropriately, I think, with his last testament, which I think is very illustrative of his thought. This is actually the handwritten manuscript version in his own hand of the his last will and testament. And I have it here in translation by Yaakov David Shulman. I'm just going to read to you a couple of sections, and you'll recognize his voice in this translation. I'm not going to translate the whole thing. It's only a few pages, but I'll translate a couple of things. So he writes here, "My sons and daughters, sons-in-law and daughters-in-law, grandchildren and great-grandchildren, lend me your ear and you will live. Let not your heart turn toward evil. Do not join the company of evildoers who follow the modern ways and who depart from Hashem and his Torah. Do not dwell near them and do not associate with them in any way, shape, or form." Note, by the way, that in my humble opinion, his greatest work was his commentary on Chovot HaLevavot, where you really get a sense of his deep, abiding ethical sense. But he is definitely monochrome and unitary on the issue of how to deal with the challenge of reform. "Do not go near the books written by Moses Mendelssohn." Right? Straight up, this is in your last will and testament. If you were a direct descendant of the Chasam Sofer, I wouldn't live on the same block as somebody who had a book of Moses Mendelssohn there. "Study Tanakh with the commentary of Rashi and engross yourself in the Torah with the commentary of Ramban. Teach the Torah to your children, for it constitutes the underpinning of our faith and embraces the universal wisdom of the ages. And if, heaven forbid, you will be plagued by the banes of hunger, thirst, and poverty, please stand this test and do not turn to false gods. Do not omit Hashem from your thoughts. Let the girls study books written in German, which are based solely on our tradition and the moral tales and insights of our sages." Now, obviously, this is well before the Beis Yaakov movement and things like that. Women did not get universal literacy in Hebrew. They would have most likely enough to pronounce the Hebrew prayers, but they would not have reading facility. "I positively and unconditionally forbid you to attend theater performances. May you merit to behold the sweetness of Hashem and the joy of his children speedily in our days. Amen." Right?
Girls and boys, right?
I assume he means the girls can't go to theater, probably the boys can't go too. Yeah. Well, it's hard to, I imagine he would forbid them both. No theater whatsoever. Okay. I'm going to read some more. It gets better. "Be strong and resolute. Study Hashem's Torah diligently and with concentration. Disseminate the Torah among the masses." He was an incredible public teacher. He apparently never missed a single day of teaching Torah in his adult life. "If your knowledge is limited, make an effort to teach others whatever you know in purity and sincerity. Hashem knows you have no ulterior motive, and that in your all sincerity, your only name is to bring honor to his great name, for a hypocrite cannot become before him. Beware of adopting..." It's interesting how the will kind of like alternates between, you know, positive panegyrics to traditional behavior and kindness and so on, to dire warnings against deviant behavior, such as, "Beware of adopting non-Jewish names, of speaking the language or dressing in the style of the non-Jew," right? Which is exactly against the whole platform of Moses Mendelssohn, right? He says, just stop it in its tracks. Don't go anywhere near there. "Never say, times have changed," We have an old father, praised is his name, who never has and never will change. A very strong statement, and you can imagine how his thought would specifically inspire the ultra-Orthodox in Brooklyn and Israel and beyond. Now, he leaves one more little addendum. That, there's like three pages or so to his children, specifically. Then he leaves instructions to his yeshiva, his community. Don't forget, he was the leader of the Jews of Pressburg, and by extension, all of Central Europe during his lifetime. Right to the very end, he writes of to the Jews of Pressburg specifically, "You are today one of the outstanding communities in the world. Never allow a person who deviates from halacha to assume the leadership of your community. Please, I implore you, do not allow the rabbinate to remain vacant for more than 2 years." It's actually kind of funny, because maybe it would take that long to find someone who was not going to deviate. "Appoint only a Talmud Chacham who has a reputation of being God-fearing and who is uncompromising in his adherence to the Torah and Halacha, a man who does not lend credence to heretical philosophies and who does not preach in the German language." This is, by the way, it was one of the hottest debates at the beginning of the 20th century in America, was whether or not American Orthodox rabbis should deliver a sermon in English. Delivering it in English was considered by the old generation to be a gross violation of everything Jewish, and by the younger American-born generation, that was considered like, what's the big deal? This is the language of the street. Why not speak about Torah in English? It shows how much has changed in over a century. I posted something on Facebook on Sunday. I went to a class with one of my favorite local rabbis, Rabbi Yaakov Trump, no relation, and I posted a picture of him giving this class. It was a great class, and I wrote in the bottom, best place to be Sunday mornings, the young Israel of Lawrence Cedarhurst. And a friend of mine who is a local historian, he writes in the comment section, "Make young Israel great again." Okay. "Select a man who delivers sermons like you heard from me, expositions of teachings and sayings of Chazal, a man who gives no special consideration of anyone and cannot be bribed either by honor, glory, or flattery. He should be a humble man who will deliver Torah public lectures to the community. The curriculum and schedule of the Torah classes should not be changed in any way. Anyone wanting to introduce changes shall be removed. Anyone promoting the traditional system of teaching Torah shall be supported. The order of prayer and the layout of the shul shall be maintained in perpetuity without the slightest change or alteration." These are, by the way, all areas where the Haskalah sought to, quote-unquote, modernize the synagogue by changing the decorum, the rituals, and so on. "Let no one dare make any changes, either in the arrangement of the interior of the shul or in the order of our prayers." And he concludes, "Our Father in heaven, raise high the pride of your people and that of the people of Pressburg in particular. Grant them material wealth, glory, and long life dedicated to the fear of Hashem and the study of Torah until the coming of Mashiach. Amen." Okay, with that, we should conclude the... do I have any other last points here? I've forgotten whether I have any points. I got so carried away. He was published after his lifetime. He only wrote a couple of things in his own lifetime that were produced while he was alive. Afterwards, volume after volume of his manuscripts were committed to print. As I mentioned, his yeshiva was transplanted from Pressburg after the war to both Brooklyn and to Jerusalem, and his philosophy is largely animating the Haredi world today. Very strong orientation to the modern world, which perhaps because we are, after all, sitting in a college that studies secular studies in order to advance students in their career and professional interests, is somewhat foreign to many of us, but nevertheless, it is an effective strategy. It has allowed the Haredim to maintain their group integrity to the present day in an impressive way. Thank you very much for your attention. I look forward to speaking with you next week.